गुड इवनिंग, वेलकम. सो कैन वी स्टार्ट?
यस, थैंक यू. गुड इवनिंग.
ओके,
नमस्कार.
गुड इवनिंग,
अनुपम जी आ गए.
डीएन सर, वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट. डीएन सर, वी आर गोइंग टू स्टार्ट.
ओके ओके
ओके. सो काइंडली म्यूट योर माइक. एंड सो formally because I'm usually I'm not going to talk anything in on this stage, but today is 25th edition of our talk, so little bit give me 2-3 minutes time to welcome our guest. Dear respected all, greeting from Department of History, Samlal Evening College. We hope you all are well. I welcome guest of the day, Professor Anupam Jha. Professor Jha is a distinguished faculty, joint proctor, as a colleague, as a friend, whom I requested at a short notice, and thankfully he agreed to grace the occasion. Fabulous. I also welcome our principal, Dr. Ramesh Kumar, who have always extended his support and encouragement for such kind of initiative. Thank you, sir. I welcome Dr. Kumar Prasant as a IQAC convener, indeed a workaholic faculty member in our college. A big round of applause for to the speakers, faculty members whom I invited for GSTS. Some of are here, GSTS series, and they always made me proud to be part of this series. To my surprise, none of these intellectuals turned down my request ever. I feel privileged because in return I could only offer them a lots of regard and gratitude. I welcome my colleagues, GSTS students, whom I want to see as a speaker for the upcoming edition, and those who spoke at this dais and gave us a sense of motivation for this initiative. Thank you very much. We indeed feel privileged. They came, they spoke, and they conquered their fear. This is the 25th edition of Talk since its inception, without any break, except one Sunday due to adversaries led by COVID. With the successful management of our students and inspiration from senior faculty members, we have together earned this credential. So I could not resist speaking this time. I really proud of Team Sakshi, GSTS, Full Form Graduates Scholar Talk Series, JCC, Journal of Continuity and Change. It's a journal, and we are going to launch second edition on 15th of August. JCC members who have worked day in, day out for 6 months to gift us this milestone moment to celebrate, to rejoice the moment of pride. They are really miracles for me during this journey. I lost my father, but never lost my faith on these little cute, passionate charmers. This has been a zero cost affair. I need support from my colleagues, my students, to promote this series. I usually think and say to my young minds, work hard in silence, let the success grow as sunshine. Parindo ko nahi di jati taleem urano ki, wo khud hi tay karte hain manzil aasmano ki, rakhta hai jo hausla aasma ko chhune ka, nahi hoti parwah use gir jane ki. Thank you very much for coming. Now I hand over to Manvi for further proceedings. Manvi, it's yours.
Thank you so much, sir. Good evening, everyone. It is my honor to welcome you all on this auspicious day where we have made it to 25th Graduate Scholar Talk Series hosted by History Department Sakshay and IQAC Internal Quality Assurance Cell. The talk series is started as an initiative to promote deep analytical approaches on variety of topics by the graduates. The research done by them leaves the audience awestruck as it shows their critical thinking. The series is spreading wings under the strong guidance of faculty advisor Dr. Manish Kanwar and student coordinators Mr. Mudit Bhardwaj, Mr. Ajay Gupta, Mr. Saurabh Singh, Mr. Vishesh Kasmi, and by me. Saraswati, the goddess of knowledge, music, art, and nature, represents the free flow of consciousness and wisdom. So now I hand over the program to Ms. Divya and Mr. Vishesh for Saraswati Vandana.
मातृ प्रणाम. एक, दो, तीन. या कुंदेन्दु तुषार हार धवला, याशुभ्रवस्त्रावृता या वीणावरदण्डमण्डितकरा या श्वेतपद्मासना या ब्रह्माच्युतशङ्कर प्रभृतिभिर् देवै सदा वन्दिता सा मां पातु सरस्वती भगवती निशेषजाड्यापः। मातृ प्रणाम एक दो तीन स्वस्थ दो तीन स्वस्थ।
श्लोक अर्थ: जो विद्या की देवी भगवती सरस्वती कुंद के फूल चंद्रमा हिमराशि और मोती के हार की तरह धवल वर्ण की है और जो श्वेत वस्त्र धारण करती है जिनके हाथ में वीणा दंड शोभ्यमान है जिन्होंने श्वेत कमलों पर आसन ग्रहण किया है तथा ब्रह्मा विष्णु एवं शंकर आदि देवताओं द्वारा जो सदा पूजित है वही संपूर्ण जड़ता और अज्ञान को दूर कर देने वाली माँ सरस्वती हमारी रक्षा करें।
थैंक यू मिस्टर दिव्या एंड मिस्टर विशेष। Now I welcome our respected principal sir, Dr. Ramesh Kumar. He has 30 years of teaching experience and has published many national and international research papers. He is a secretary of Gandhi Ashram, which is located at GTP Nagar. Sir is a political analyst, an author, and a Gandhian activist. Sir, I request you to please grace us with your words.
All of you, you rightly said, I am speaking out from the Gandhi Ashram. You see, the humid atmosphere. I'm sweating outside because I don't have network in my room. Partly it is Gandhian and partly it is so-called deficit of Digital India. This is the situation of Digital India in the metropolitan city, the capital of the country. Anyway, so let me congratulate the entire JSTS team for continuously, consecutively, and quite laboriously to carry out this academic mission for 25 series. This is 25th series, I am told. So it would not be a generation if we call you academic barriers to carry this mission with extraordinary zeal and mission. Once again, I admire, applaud, and hats off to all of you, entire team. Led by Manish Karambar, inspired by QC coordinator Dr. Kumar Prasant, and cooperated by all our United colleagues. Friends, my guest is here, Kanpam Jha is here. You will be able to throw some academic and excellent light on this, but being a general student of political science, the topic I'm told is sedition. What does sedition mean? Sedition means something against the nation, if I'm right. Right, Manish? It's against the nation. Sedition is somewhat defined, or somewhat live in gray area. Sedition, if it is done for the nation against colonial rule, is called patriotism by freedom fighters. At the same time, sedition by the colonial rulers. This legacy continued thereafter, even after post-colonial India. There are provisions in articles, you see the preamble, and then you're talking about liberty. Liberty of thought, expression, belief, faith, and birthright. But all these, including all seven set of freedoms given in Article 19(1) of the Constitution of India, which has been amended now more than 100 times, also say you have all freedom to say everything, go everywhere, do whatever you like. But at the same time, there are reasonable restrictions. Those restrictions, among other things, are also included sedition. Your speech, your writing, your picture, your cartoon, none of them should incite violence or prove catalyst for anything that is against the nation. These days, seditions are also used as a tool to suppress freedom. Am I right, Manish? Manish, I would not like to give a series of examples, but to try to understand, try to analyze, try to examine the incidence of sedition misused, misinterpreted, and misappropriated also. Many journalists, opposition leaders are put behind the bar, or the writings are being banned because it leads to sedition. I don't know how does it affect the sovereignty, unity, integrity, or social order, or peace, or our effect in the relation with the other nations. I don't know. Sedition is a very vague, as you told, gray areas. How do you see what to me the patriotism Bhagat Singh for us is a nationalist, and for Britishers they are an example of Britishness. So now, suggestions. You see, I would like to suggest to you as a researcher, please read our Professor Ujjwal Singh's literature. He has very eloquently talked about freedoms and seditions also. Why people in jail? Why people have been put behind the bars in colonial India, as well as post-colonial India? What is sedition law? How has it been interpreted and implemented? So, if you want to know much about seditions, it is not a good test, it is very good in academic test. So, to know more about it, you should read literatures, listen to experts like Anupam Jha, listen to experience of Manish Ji as a historian, explain what has been sedition, what has been said, medieval phase and modern India phase and after colonial and now modern and postmodern. There are many things, you know, truth and post-truth, whatever it is. So, I would not like to extend your lecture, extend my lecture for a long time, because my duty is to listen to the experts, not to a general admissions from the angle of political science. It is basically science of Indian penal code, criminology, jurisprudence. So better to listen to an expert. Unfortunately, you have amongst yourself great expert, Dr. Anupam Jha. He is legal expert, legal professor, and this issue is basically a legal issue, a legal topic. I fail to understand how this subject becomes so dear to the historian, the students of the history. Basically, it is legal science and the jurisprudence and the criminology and constitutional law. But there is no limit or boundary. It is an era of interdisciplinary approach. So if history department are there to venture into other disciplines, it's good, it's healthy sign. And now again, I congratulate this entire academic team, like academic barriers of youth, middle-aged, experienced people. Dr. Dean Singh is here. He'd also like to give his opinion on this. So I wish now to bind up my words so that the other experts can share his view, expert view on this. So again, I bind up myself now. I wish at the end to thank all the organizers and also thank you to Dr. Kumar Prasant, who doing wonderful job in coordination with IQAC, that all together collectively enhance our college so that we can come out with flying colors at the time of our IQAC and NAC. So with this, thank you all of you for giving me opportunity to say. Thanks a lot. And I should be allowed to go in my room here. And Manish, if not possible for me to continue, I want to leave. I'm here in the meeting also. I'm in a Gandhi Ashram since 10 o'clock. I will be staying here for another 1 hour. So I'm staying outside in a very humid atmosphere. So this is all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Now, we are honored to have today's respected chief guest, Dr. Anupam Jha, Professor, Faculty of Law from University of Delhi. Sir has published many research papers in national and international journals. He is also the member of Commonwealth Academic Staff and has conducted research relating to advocacy of law on human trafficking. Sir has pursued his LLB and LLM from University of Delhi and from University of Kansas and University of Mauritius. He has been remarkable understanding on international law, renewable energy, environment, and human trafficking. Sir, I request you to please share your valuable with us.
Manish, before we start the academic discussion. Actually, I would like to say something.
अनुपम ब्लेसिंग्स देंगे और लास्ट में सर वो अपना आइडिया
मैंने कहा कि उनके पहले था चलो ठीक है कोई नहीं
अनुपम प्लीज
Good evening, all of you, and it's my pleasure and honor to be in Shyam Lal College program. This is a evening course. This is evening college, and I was not aware of this fact that Shyam Lal College is also an evening college. And so this is only because of Dr. Manish Karamwar that I came to know that it's an evening college also. And I can't believe myself that. Students can be motivated to this level by a good faculty member. And students can discuss, deliberate, and expose themselves to many other audiences. And that too belonging to a history department in a college. So it's really a remarkable thing today to see the feat of Dr. Manish Karamwar motivating the students of Shyam Lal College evening. And I must congratulate the students of Shyam Lal College History Department and all other departments of the college that they are joining in this graduate talk series. This is a series, so it seems as if this series should never come to an end. And Manish is himself Manish, so perhaps this will be crowned by a person like Manish, who will be always showing you the light that the series would be a great effort, collective effort by the students of Shyam Lal College evening and the faculty members. So that collective effort must be going to such a height that students during Corona times, I was also impressed to know that during Corona times even, and there was no break in this graduate talk series, because it's very difficult to organize a series of talks weekly on a weekly basis. I can definitely say that it can be a Herculean task for all of you, but to continue, not to stop it, and have it going on with your flag showing very high, that is a very good sign. And the topic that you have chosen is also very contemporary. Most of the statements and most of the news items nowadays which are coming, that sometimes may be connected to the word sedition. So the thing is that this time, this topic that you have taken today, there are many earlier examples of seditious acts or seditious statements, and what is the meaning of sedition. People have been deliberating on it, but today's program, in which you are going to discuss, perhaps that will again open up a new meaning, a new chapter, a new dimension to this sedition. So first of all, I would like to hear the speaker of today's graduate series talk, and then only once he would come to an end, and then I can give my comments. Perhaps that would be better, because today is a time to, you know, to understand the dimension of the student, to understand the perspective of a student, like a student who is Mudit Bhardwaj perhaps. And it would be very nice to first of all hear him, and then say my own views, and not my own views, but you know how this sedition has been has played a very important role in the law, how the law has to combat sedition, and how law has done it. That little bit I will try to take up later on. So thank you so much for inviting me today on a Sunday. And I'm so much impressed, because I was thinking that today is Sunday will come, but then I can see that century has been made. I can see the numbers, and that shows that how popular this program has become. Thank you so much for inviting. I congratulate Dr. Manish Kanambar and the principal of the college, Dr. Ram Kumar, and Mr. Prashant Pandey, and Dr. D.N. Singh. Perhaps I could hear his voice after a long time today when he talked and called me. And then I was so happy to hear his voice after a long time. Thank you so much, Dr. Manish and Dr. D.N. Singh, so that we are together today. Thank you. So please take it over.
Thank you so much, sir. Now, I welcome our special guest, Dr. Kumar Prashant, who is an associate professor in Department of Political Science at Shyamlal College Evening, Delhi University. Sir has 20 plus years of teaching experience. He had got many of his articles published in research papers in national and international journals. His area of specialization is public administration and public policy making. Sir is also the convener of IQAC, Internal Quality Assurance Cell. Sir, I request you to please say some valuable words.
Thank you, Manvi. I think Manvi is speaking, na? Okay. I welcome on behalf of IQAC all guests, chief guests of today program, and Manish ji, D.N. Singh sir, Vikas, Dr. Vikas ji. He's a good friend of mine, and I have seen a long time back. Actually, this is Corona time, so we are not meeting. That's the problem. But on behalf of IQAC and History Department, I welcome everyone and everyone. So today, GSTS program, actually, it was started by Manish ji. This is the brainchild of Manish ji. And he's very active. He talked to me because being a convener of IQAC, I suggested him that you will do, and this will be a good thing, because it is not the part of the faculties only, but it is also the part of the student who will learn a lot. through this kind of activities, because at the corona time we are the students are not at the college and at home. If they will do this kind of activities, they are motivated also. They could be more appreciable to our teachers, our faculties, and they think that we are the part of the college, because they are now very much active in this program. I welcome Mudit also, because Mudit is my student and he is speaking today on tradition. बहुत अच्छा है मुदित, तुम अच्छा बोलते हो और अच्छा लगेगा तुम्हारे बारे में सुनना, क्योंकि मैं आज टॉपिक के बारे में आई विल नॉट टेल एनीथिंग, क्योंकि टॉपिक आज आप बोलोगे और फिर हमारे जो आज के गेस्ट हैं डॉक्टर अनुपम झा, वो उनका सुनेंगे. अच्छा है, बहुत अच्छा प्रोग्राम हम लोग का चल रहा है हिस्ट्री डिपार्टमेंट. खासकर मैं मनीष जी को बहुत बहुत बधाई दूंगा या कॉन्ग्रेचुलेट करूंगा, क्योंकि उनका हमेशा से इनिशिएटिव कुछ नया रहता है और हर मेरे साथ और भी कई तरह के एक्टिविटीज में वो हमेशा जुड़े रहते हैं. तो मैं तहे दिल से मनीष जी का शुक्रिया करता हूँ कि उन्होंने मुझे बुलाया और मुझे अवसर दिया कि आप लोगों के समक्ष जो बातें कर सकें. धन्यवाद सर.
थैंक यू सो मच सर. नाउ लेट्स स्टार्ट द मेन पार्ट ऑफ द प्रोग्राम, द टॉक ऑफ द सेशन. सो आई कॉल मिस्टर मुदित भारद्वाज टू प्रेजेंट हिज ओपिनियंस ऑन द टॉपिक सेडिशन, अ सार्डोनिकल सागा.
Thank you, Manvi. Thank you, sir. Whoever my words, either spoken or written or by sign or by visible representation or otherwise, brings or attempts to bring hatred, contempt, or excites or attempts to excite disaffection towards the government established by law in India, shall be punished with imprisonment for life or with imprisonment which may extend to 3 years, to which fine may be added, or with fine. Yes, you got that right. We are talking about the notorious sedition, section 124A of the Indian Penal Code. I need not to examine the fact that this is probably the most tendentious and misapprehended set of words breathing in the law books, and have oft times invited obloquy and opprobrium. Good evening, everyone. I am Mudit Bhardwaj, third year student of BA Honours Political Science, Shyamlal College, Evening. I am contented to have this opportunity to expound my words on 25th session of Graduate Scholars Talk Series on the topic Sedition, a Sardonical Saga. I need not to highlight why I have chosen to speak on this very topic. You all must have came across the debates going on around this law, and it is something which hasn't left the corridors of prominent institutions like DU, JNU, AMU, among the others. What the issue is, rulers everywhere tend to treat trenchant criticism as part of attempt to excite disaffection and disloyalty. That is perhaps the only reason why Section 124A of the Indian Penal Code, enacted under colonial rule, remains on the statute book. There have been repeated instances of its misuse. Regimes at the center and states have often been shown in poor light after they invoked the section against activists, detractors, writers, cartoonists, journalists, professors, civil society members, among the others. Since independence, many have seen the irony of retaining a provision that was used extensively to crush any uprising for freedom struggle. Despite all this, Section 124A has tenaciously survived all attempts by successive generations to reconsider it, if not repeal it together. To understand the operation of the sedition law, we need to look back at the time in which it was incorporated into the IPC. In 1837, Thomas Babington Macaulay first mooted the idea of a sedition law in India, by which time it had practically become a dead letter in Great Britain. He introduced sedition as an offence through clause 113 of the draft Indian Penal Code. Macaulay died in 1859. However, when in 1860 IPC was enacted, IPC was the first ever codification of offences and penalties in India. Under the supervision of Sir Barnes Peacock, and the section pertaining to sedition was omitted, and this was surprising for many. Many British lawmakers saw this as a dangerous development, because they believed that the press had to be kept in check through such a law, or they would further an anti-colonial agenda. Bombay High Court advocate Abhinav Chandrachud writes in his book, Republic of Rhetoric, Free Speech and the Case of India, and Law Commission consultation paper of 2018 states that James Stephen, when he was asked about this omission, he referred to the letter written by Sir Barnes Peacock to Sir Henry James Sumner Mayne. He had remarked that, I have looked into my notes. And I think the omission of section 113 of the original Penal Code must have been through mistake. I feel that it was an oversight of the committee to not substitute for section 113. British suspicions about increasing voices for independence and Wahhabi activities in the subcontinent led to inclusion of sedition in 1970 under section 124A. Section 124A came under chapter 6, which provides for offences against the state, and it was piloted by James Stephen. This section was in line with the Treason Felony Act 1848 that penalized seditious expressions. One of the reasons cited by Mr. James Stephen for introducing this section was that in the absence of such a provision, this law would be penalized under the more severe common law of England. According to him, the adopted clause in India was much more compressed, much more distinctly expressed, and freed from great amount of obscurity and vagueness with which the law of England was hampered. Section 124A was not the only law of such type that gave free speech. There were other short-lived laws as well, such as Vernacular and Press Act of 1878, the Newspaper Incitement of Offences Act of 1908, and the Indian Press Act of 1910. These acts gave legal backing to the state to restrict voices which went against it. In the year 1892, it saw the first recorded state trial for sedition in Queen Empress versus Jogendra Chandra Bose and others. I won't go into the details of what all these cases were. I will just highlight the main interpretation of these cases because these are necessary to understand the journey of sedition. In this case, Calcutta High Court had emphasized upon the distinction between the terms disapprobation, which means legitimate criticism, and disaffection, which refers to any feeling contrary to affection. The court concluded that since only affection is penalized, the offense of sedition does not take people's right away. The next landmark case on this matter was that of Queen Empress versus Bal Gangadhar Tilak and Keshav Mahadevan in 1897. In this case, Justice Strachey placed relevant material before the jury for interpreting disaffection by saying that it means hatred, enmity, dislike, hostility, contempt, and every form of ill will to the government. Disloyalty is perhaps the best term, comprehending every possible form of bad feelings to the government. This way, the Bombay High Court virtually disallowed all legitimate criticism. 124A was then amended in 1898 for the first time. Bal Gangadhar Tilak was again charged with the sedition in 1960. Then Mahatma Gandhi was charged in March 1922, and in his trial speech he said, "Section 124A, under which I am happily charged, is perhaps the prince among the political sections designed to suppress the liberty of Indian citizens." 124A was then again amended in 1937. It took many years for the definition of sedition to change in India. In the Federal Court in 1942, Chief Justice Morris Guyer, he explained that the offense of sedition was not meant to minister to the wounded vanity of government. Even vulgar abuse, he said, was not sedition as it was the stop in the demagogue. However, Guyer was soon overruled by the Privy Council in London in 1947. Meanwhile, the country got independent, new constitution was to be framed. The issue of sedition was also discussed in the Constituent Assembly. From the Constituent Assembly debates, it is clear that there had been serious opposition for inclusion of sedition as a restriction on free speech and expression under the then Article 30 of the draft Indian Constitution. Chitranshu Sinha, in his book, The Great Repression, The Story of Sedition in India, put light on these debates. He quoted Somnath Lahiri, who said, according to Sardar Patel, seditious speech is a punishable crime. C. Rajagopalachari wanted to make this provision more stringent. Somnath Lahiri, Damodar Swarup said, K. Munshi, all the three were in vehement opposition of adding sedition. Thereafter, K. Munshi went on to propose an amendment to Article 13, whereby he sought to remove the word sedition from the list of restrictions to free speech. During the discussions, MAMS said, if we find that the government for the time being has a knack of entrenching itself, however bad its administration might be, it must be the fundamental duty of every citizen in the country to overthrow that government without violence. The word sedition has become obnoxious in the previous regime. We had therefore approved of the amendment that the word sedition ought to be removed. But sedition under section 124A of IPC continued to be a statutory offense, as Article 372 of the Indian Constitution provides that any existing law as of January 1950 would continue to be in force unless explicitly modified or repealed by the legislature. In independent India, section 124A came up for consideration for the first time in case of Ramesh Thapar versus State of Madras. The Supreme Court in this case declared that unless the freedom of speech and expression threaten the security of or tend to overthrow the state, any law imposing restriction upon the same would not fall within the purview of Article 19, Clause 2 of the Constitution. Then in November 1950, a bench of Punjab at Haryana High Court comprising of Chief Justice Eric Westson and Justice Khosla, they stated that the law of sedition thought necessary during a period of foreign rule has become inappropriate by the very nature of change which Indian democratic state has came about, and consequently it held the section to be void. In 1951, something uncommon happened. First Constitutional Amendment Act was brought in, 16 stormy days, a book written by historian Tripur Dhawan Singh, exclusively dedicated to this First Constitutional Amendment Act, writes that First Amendment to the Constitution revalidated the sedition law. It put more restrictions on free speech as public order and relations with friendly state were added another grounds, because this term public order, it basically had wide gamut which is not defined what actually constitutes violation of public order. Tellingly, in the parliamentary debates, Mr. Nehru said that now, so far as I am concerned, this particular section is highly objectionable and obnoxious. It should have no place both for historical and practical reasons. If anybody of us like in anybody of laws that we might pass, the sooner we get rid of it, the better. So Tripur Dhawan Singh says that what was happening and being said was diametrically opposite. Nehru, of course, recognized the pitfalls of sedition, and even after bringing the first amendment, he warned his chief ministers against misusing this provision. Section 124A was then amended in 1955. And until then, from then, it had been left untouched by the parliament, and it is the present form which I spoke earlier. Now here we need to understand that what does disaffection mean? Disaffection, according to the 1955 law, includes disloyalty and all feelings of enmity. However, disapprobation of the measures or administrative action of the government to obtain their alteration by lawful means do not constitute an offense under the sedition. This is what the law as amended in Article 1955 says. Now in 1960, there was a case named Superintendent Central Prison, Fatehgarh versus Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia. This case is generally overlooked while we do talk about the significant judgments related to the sedition. And this case is over and over found missing in the judgments of Apex Court as well. And why I'm highlighting this point, because the pronouncement in this case was very important and clear cut. Honorable Supreme Court in this case said that a proximate connection or nexus with public order, but not one far-fetched, hypothetical or problematic or too remote in the chain of its relation with the public order could be upheld under Article 19.2. This judgment I will explain later. Moving on, you all must have heard about the famous Kedarnath Singh versus State of Bihar case. It is being cited in almost every verdict of High Court and Supreme Court related to sedition. The Constitution bench upheld the validity of Section 124A and capped it at a different pedestal. The court drew a line between the terms "the government established by law" and "the persons for the time being in carrying the administration." This is quite interesting to know that it means you can criticize Prime Minister, you can criticize Home Minister, Finance Minister, or anyone for that matter, but that would not mean you are criticizing the government. Here, Supreme Court tried to define the limits of sedition and held that a citizen has a right to say or write whatever he likes about the government or its measure by way of criticism or comment, so long as he does not contemplate or incite people to violence against the government established by law or with intention of creating public disorder. Now, CRPC of 1898 was replaced by CRPC of 1973 by Indira Gandhi government, which made sedition a cognizable offense. And here begin mess. About this development, Abhinav Chandrachud writes, sedition became a self-inflicted wound. Now, sedition is classified as cognizable. Cognizable offense means the police officer can arrest you without the warrant and even can start an investigation without the permission of the court. Non-compoundable, which means not allowing a compromise between the accused and the victim. And non-bailable, which means the accused cannot get the bail as a matter of right in case of sedition, but it is subject to the discretion of session judge. Thus, the judicial oversight, which was available earlier, has gone. This has given unbridled power to the police to arrest people on allegation of sedition. Supreme Court in Balwant Singh versus State of Punjab 1995 had said that casual raising of slogans once or twice by individuals cannot be said to be aimed at exciting or attempt to excite hatred or disaffection towards government established by law, and hence Section 124A pertaining to sedition would not be addressed. In Shreya Singhal case of 2015, although this case was not related to sedition, Supreme Court held that the distinction between advocacy and incitement is grounded in the idea of proximity and imminence. Now, this judgment is similar to that of Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia case. What Supreme Court said in both these cases was that there must be incitement to violence at first place, and that incitement must be imminent. It means it must not be like if I have said something today and someone would be fascinated with, by my words and would resort to violence a year later. No, that can't be a restriction on freedom of speech and expression. So these were certain adjudications which are important to understand and frequently cited while deciding sedition. Now we have got to know that judiciary has tried to define and restrict the spectrum of sedition. But where the whole problem is, we have to understand that it is the language in which legislative intent is expressed. And this language often gives rise to interpretations, and same is the case here. This language can be interpreted any way as would suit the executive at a given time. And who is the implementing body? Police thanas. Of course, they will make advantage of this ambiguity. Overzealous police authorities invoke this section only in order to curry favors with their political bosses. You know, you don't have the evidence, just invoke sedition and put the person behind bars. The process often becomes punishment as lower court refuses to grant bail or examine the charges thoroughly. When matter reaches to apex court, those are of high profile journalist or some esteemed figure, they are heard and rest languish in jail for years. And what state reveals is highly, highly alarming. According to data from National Crime Records Bureau, there had been a significant increase in the number of cases being filed under Section 124A of the IPC, with such cases being risen by 160% from year 2016 to 2019. As latest report of National Crime Records Bureau pertains to 2019, it held that in 2016, the conviction rate was 33.3%, while in 2019, it was mere 3.3%. In 2019, 93 cases of sedition were filed in which 96 people were arrested. Ministry of Home Affairs, while asked in a written reply in February 2021, informed the Rajya Sabha, and appallingly, only 2 were convicted for crime, while 29 were acquitted, and investigation and trials are ongoing in the rest. This clearly indicates that the state has been misusing this provision to fight baseless or frivolous cases. Such abuse is bound to affect the free speech of citizens by forcing them to self-censor. And several times charge slips filed over a number of people. If I give you one example, in March 2011, right when India began testing equipment and first nuclear power plant at Kodankulam, protests erupted aftermath of Fukushima nuclear disaster in Japan, with protesters raising concern about the safety of plant. You won't believe, 21 cases of sedition were filed against 8,956 people, and 21 cases of waging war against the state were filed against 11,000 people, along with other cases being filed simultaneously. And this was when Supreme Court has directed 240 cases to be withdrawn. Can you imagine the extent of misuse of such draconian laws? These data unequivocally belie the claim of retaining such provisions. It raises a very fundamental question, that are democratic Indian government using this as an archaic tool to suppress the voices raised against them? And after the advent of constitution, everybody has got the right of freedom of speech and expression within certain restrictions. And that fundamental right is being stifled by these false sedition cases being foisted on outspoken critics of the powers that be. Honorable Chief Justice himself stated that a number of petitions in sedition cases have been filed, highlighting the chilling effect sedition has on the fundamental right of freedom of speech and expression. And he asked Attorney General, your government is taking out stale laws from the law books. Why have they not looked into this? Why it is continuing even after 7 decennies? The parliament is not likely to dilute or scrap this law, at least in near future, because as I said in Rajya Sabha, when a Ministry of Home Affairs was asked, they wrote that this IPC provision need to be retained to effectively combat anti-national, secessionist and terrorist activities. And then in March 2021, when Telangana MP Anumula Revan Reddy, he asked government about his stand, it was also a stark question. To be more particular, it was question number 281. And not to the much surprise, Ministry of Home Affairs came with a reply that amendment of a criminal law is a continuous process. Apart from that, various scholars have written that Indian courts must adopt what some Western countries are following, that is test-based effect. If we take example of Britain, and why I'm quoting this, it's not only because Britain brought sedition to India, it is the country which introduced this concept of sedition to the world. The offense of sedition in Britain can be traced back to the Statute of Westminster 1275, when the king was considered as the divine holder of rights. The Sedition Act 1661 imposed punishment of anyone who wrote, prints, or preached any word against the king. But by the 18th century, the law had received much more criticism there, and from 1832 onwards, the prosecution in these cases were so rare that the offenses had virtually ceased to exist. In 1977, a working paper was published by the Law Commission suggesting the abolishment of the Act, and noted that historical examination of sedition shows that most often prosecution had a political motive. And this I'm talking about Britain. 32 years later, in 2009, Section 73 of the Coroners and Justice Act abolished the sedition law in Britain. The Parliamentary Undersecretary of State at the Ministry of Justice, Claire Ward, while this law was being discussed there, she said, sedition and defamatory libel are arcane offenses from a bygone era when freedom of expression wasn't considered as a right as it is today. The existence of these obsolete offenses in this country had been used by other countries as justification for the retention of similar laws, which have been decisively used to suppress political dissent and restrict freedom of speech and expression. If we see US, the United States Constitution itself proscribed the state from enacting any legislation which curtails the First Amendment, that is freedom of speech and expression. In 1798, the Sedition Act was passed under the presidency of John Adams. John Adams passed this law to criminalize the making of false statement against the federal government. This act, however, was repealed in 1820. In 1918, Sedition Act was again enacted by the US Congress to protect American interest in the First World War. But through several pronouncements of Supreme Court over time, restrictions of speech are subjected to intense scrutiny. The US Supreme Court in cases of Eugene Debs and Schenck versus United States also highlighted that the charge of sedition had often had a political persuasion. Thus, criticism or advocacy must lead to incitement of immediate lawless action in order to qualify for reasonable restriction of First Amendment. In Australia, through the National Security Legislation Act of 2010, the term sedition was removed, and a new term which was brought in was urging to violent offenses. In New Zealand, sedition ceased to be a crime following the introduction of the crime repeal of seditious offenses amendment bill in 2007. In Canada, there had been no new sedition brought to light after the 20th century. Of course, that doesn't mean that if they are not following these laws, we must also do away with this law. We have to look at another side of coin as well, that mere misuse of law cannot be a ground to repeal the law for its discontinuance. We do require the law to meet certain situations. It is argued that Section 124A, it protects the elected government of the day from attempts to overthrow it with violent and illegal means. Another argument is given that this matter has knocked the doors of judiciary several times. Judiciary itself hasn't stepped it. Even the Law Commission has examined the issue, and the conclusion that has been drawn so far is that there is need to retain Section 124A. And why there is need to retain Section 124A? Because the context and the cause of the Section 124A has not disappeared yet. The physicalist tendencies are still alive. The divisive forces are still alive. Many parts of the country still face extremist Maoist insurgencies. Rebel group virtually ran a parallel administration there. These groups openly advocate the overthrow of state government by revolution. So what we can do there? We have a strong and independent judiciary which takes care of anyone who has been released will not be immediately crucified. There is a procedure of trial, and that trial is under due process of law. And anyone who goes through that due process of law, if found guilty, will be a rare case where sedition will take place. What can we do to prevent the misuse while retaining the provision? What can be the possible safeguard? First of all, it must be made a non-cognizable and bailable offense. This is very, very important. Punishment should be reviewed again, because the punishment now can extend up to life imprisonment. The most important of all is to educate the law enforcing authorities and ready coming down penalties on them if they don't follow the prescribed norms. In case sedition is registered in any police station, that station in charge must primarily confirm that it is in line with the Kedarnath Singh case and Ram Manohar Lohia case. And that station in charge must report to the district magistrate within 48 hours, and the investigation should be done by an officer of at least SP rank. Every magistrate shall be bound with what is said in Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia case. It must be the duty of magistrate to strike such ridiculous cases down at the bar. The government shall at very least propose certain amendments and add more explanation which are in conformity with the Kedar Nath Singh and Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia case, because at the end of the day, everything depends on executive's will. And finally, I will just say, singing from the same songbook is not a benchmark of patriotism in a democracy. People should be at liberty to show their affection towards their country in their own way. For doing the same, one might indulge in constructive criticism or debates, or might express a thought that is not in consonance with the policies of the government of the day. Of course, expressions used in such thought might be harsh to some, might be unpleasant to some, but that does not render the acts to be branded seditious. Section 124A should be invoked only in cases where the intention behind any act is to disrupt public order or to overthrow the state with violent and illegal means. Law should be only applied after completely investigating the motive and the result of the said opinion. While it is essential to protect the national integrity, however, it should not be used to quieten the disquiet under the pretense of muzzling miscreants. Dissent and criticism are essential ingredients of a robust public debate on public issues as part of vibrant democracy. Therefore, every restriction of free speech and expression must be carefully scrutinized to avoid unwarranted restrictions. As Law Commission report of 2018 said, that it is the time when we need to rethink or repeal of the sedition law. In order to study the revision of sedition law, certain issues would require consideration, and those issues are: should sedition be not defined in a country like India, which is the world's largest democracy, considering that right to speech and expression is an essential ingredient of democracy ensured as a fundamental right? Second, will it be worthwhile to think of an option of renaming the section with a suitable substitute for the term sedition and imposing punishment accordingly? And what is the extent to which citizen of our country may enjoy the right to offend, and at what point of time will this right to offend would qualify as hate speech? Given the fact that all existing statutes cover the various offenses against the individual and states, will reducing the rigor of Section 124A or repealing it, will it be detrimental or beneficial to the nation? In a country where contempt of court invites penal action, should the contempt of government or any hate speech against government, it should not invite punishment? You know, as judiciary is one part of the government, so is the executive. What could be the possible safeguard to ensure that Section 124A is not misused further? Summing up about this law, I must say, in this era, at least we don't need this vaguely worded sort of sedition to be used at unregulated discretion of an unaccountable police system, and about which Honorable Chief Justice Dr. N.V. Ramanna held a few days back that the use of sedition is like giving a saw to the carpenter to cut a piece of wood, and he uses it to cut the entire forest itself. I feel that sums up the course and action of sedition and brings me to the end of my words as well. Thank you. Thank you for your time and attention.
Thank you, Mr. Mudit, for this sublime presentation. You know, this couldn't have been better. You talked about this draconian law right from the moment when it was used to curb the nationalist feeling among us, and today also when it is so vaguely misused by governments. At the same time, I totally stand with you on the fact that, you know, mere misuse of law is not a ground to repeal it. So we certainly need a more strict system of checks and balance for this law. But at the same time, when we look at some of the recent news relating to this Pegasus malware, you know, using it for surveillance into some high profile targets, is a clear sign that we are definitely facing a slow erosion of our democracy. There is a definite loss of personal liberty, be it in the case of Section 124A or this Pegasus spyware. There is definitely a constraint on our freedom of thought, speech, and expression and privacy. And we certainly need to address this problem as soon as possible. Now with this, let us move to some of the questions that were posted by our listeners. So the first question is from Kashish Kamra. She is asking, do you think passing of quota, UAPA, TADA, etc. are also the part of evolution of sedition laws? And is it right to blame the Britishers always for introducing the laws to us when our own government is strengthening it?
Of course, I agree with what Kashish has said, because we can't blame everything on Britishers. See, we can't say like it is a colonial hangover anymore, so let's do away with this. No, this can't be the logic. Of course, it was brought by the imperial masters, but it has been 7 decades where we got independence. It has been again and again amended by our parliament. It has been interpreted in many ways by the judiciary. So we can't say like it is colonial construction anymore. And about what she said that UAPF quota, of course, these are said to be the evolution of sedition, because when the 1951 amendment, which I talked about, that writer, Tripurtaman Singh says, himself says that this law gave this law of sedition, it gives birth to many laws such as UAPA, quota, NSA, and many other laws. So we can exactly say that these other laws are evolution of sedition.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Mudit. So another question is from Mr. Habibullah. He's asking that Supreme Court is always hearing this case again and again and asking the parliament to repeal it. Can't Supreme Court do this by itself?
Of course, Supreme Court can, and Supreme Court has done that in past as well. But what the problem is, see, there can be two ways to repeal any law. Either parliament can repeal the law or Supreme Court can scrap the law. If I give you one example, Section 66A of the Information Technology Act 2000, it was repealed way back in 2015 in Sri Single versus Union of India case. But here the problem is, those laws which are repealed by Supreme Court are misused further. Section 66A, which I quoted just, it is being misused today as well. Even N.V. Ramanna, the Chief Justice of India, he himself asked government that who will help the accountability of the laws which are being scrapped by Supreme Court. And probably I feel that's the reason why Supreme Court is not scrapping the law.
Okay, Mr. Mudit, I will take one last question. That is from Mr. Arpit Thakur. He's asking that Britishers brought this law to suppress us, and now Britain itself has repealed it. Shouldn't we also repeal it? Why should we use this law now?
Again, I would say the same thing, that of course, this can't be a ground anymore that it is a colonial relic. We do agree that it is a colonial construction, but we have to understand that it has been 70 years since our country got independent. Judiciary has interpreted it at least 10 times. Even what Indian Parliament is doing, if they feel it is a colonial law, then they can simply do away with this law. And one more thing I would like to add here, that your whole of IPC, it is a colonial construction. So can we do away with whole of IPC as well? No, that can't be the logic to do away with any law that it is a colonial construction. If you are applying the same logic, then just do away with Indian Constitution, just do away with IPC.
So thank you, Mr. Mudit. That was very nicely answered. Now back over to you, Ms. Manvi.
Okay, thank you. Now I would like to call Ms. Amrita from Lady Sri Ram College, who is the speaker for next week, to give a brief about her topic.
A very warm good evening to all. I am Amrita Ravishankar. I am doing my graduation in first year, BA Political Science Honours from Lady Sri Ram College. So first of all, I would like to utilize this amazing opportunity to deliver my sincere gratitude towards all the faculty members and those all the enthusiastic students who are engaged with this innovative project of Graduate Scholars Talk Series, which is providing with an enlightening opportunity for each of the students who wishes to come out of their comfort zones and to be enthusiastically associated with these kinds of talks. So on the coming Sunday, that is August 8th, I have received a privileged opportunity to present my views on the most sensational topic, electoral democracy of India, burning issues and reforms. So I'm really glad to be part of this session, as well as on coming Sunday, I assure each one of you that all of you will be gaining the correct opportunity or the most transparent space to discuss about the most controversial issues which are being faced by the electoral arena of Indian democracy, so that we will be having a great evening in which we will be dealing with some of the most burning topics, structure of election commission, which was instituted since 1950, and so. Also, we will be dealing with several questions which will be coming into your mind with a spirit of inquiry. So I cordially invite each one of you to attend the next session, which is going to be held on next Sunday, August 8th, on the topic Electoral Democracy in India, Burning Issues and Reforms. So there I am waiting for each one of you to interact with all of you and to get motivated by the wide diversity of questions which are going to be asked by each one of you. So once again, I'm sharing my happiness to be part of this talk series, as well as I'm cordially inviting each one of you for that occasion. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Amrita. Now, I would like to call our respected chief guest for his final remarks about the talk.
Thank you, Manvi. It was nice listening to Mudit Bhardwaj. If I would have been the Dean of Law Faculty of University of Delhi, I would have directly given him admission to Law Faculty without any entrance. It was really a nice presentation on sedition, and I was wondering how he could relate the legal aspects in the topic of sedition. And perhaps he has done very meticulously, taking up many cases and the reports of Law Commission of India and the National Crime Records Bureau data. So many things he related to, and he also discussed that how the evolution of the laws and many aspects related to law on sedition that have been made in India. He took up many cases, including Kedarnath case, which is a very important case. That was a case which is a pillar on the whole case law on sedition in Law Faculty of University of Delhi. We do not believe in just naming the section and telling our students to just memorize it. But we have to also say them that you please apply the law. And the teacher who teaches constitutional law, then that teacher must not only just say their students to just know about Section 124A of the Indian Penal Code, as well as how does it relate to the Constitution of India. But he or she will also say that how can it be applied in a particular case, and likewise this case study method that was introduced first of all by the Law Faculty of University of Delhi all over India, and now it has been emulated in many of the universities, law universities, and also in traditional universities. So this Kedarnath case is a very important case, Kedarnath versus State of Bihar. And you know what? Mudit could not tell us all the facts because he had the paucity of time, but I could say that the person Kedarnath, he was a leader of a very small party, Communist Party, Maoist Communist Party. And he was delivering a speech in a small town of Bihar, that is Begusarai. And there he made a speech which to the then political establishment, they thought that it was seditious, and thereafter case was filed, FIR was lodged, and then he was put in jail, and thereafter the matter ultimately went to the Supreme Court, and in Supreme Court it was a very important discussion that took place. It was a question, it was a debate between freedom of speech and expression, and this law, draconian law, as Mudit was saying, that was incorporated in Section 124A of IPC. So that debate is very interesting. If you look through the judgment, Justice Sinha, who was the Chief Justice of Supreme Court at that moment of time, along with his four co-learned judges, they all, delved into different aspects of sedition, and how Macaulay and how Stephen, they all discussed it, and they ultimately it was incorporated. And I am very happy that some of the questions which were directed to Mudit were like that, why do we need sedition law even now? And some of the questions were like, why does not Supreme Court just scrap the sedition law? But the thing is that even today, if you look at the Law Commission report, if you look at Kedarnath Singh judgment, if you look at, even today, even in this year, there was a judgment by the Supreme Court in which an MP from Andhra Pradesh, Mr. Raju, perhaps. So he was arrested on sedition charge, and he was not given bail because this is a non-bailable offense. So he was not given bail, and ultimately he had to go to the Supreme Court, praying to the court that please give me bail. And it was not a seditious statement. You know, so a statement, sometimes, you know, you make a statement, and can it become a sedition? Now, these are the very crucial questions which Mudit replied in a very good way. So I'm very happy that Mudit took up this burning issue today. And I'm so glad that he really analyzed different aspects of this topic. Thank you so much, Mudit, and thank you, Shyamalal College, and particularly, I'm very happy to see that Dr. Manish Karambar has been successfully doing all these things, and I'm very happy that he has, you know, mentored the students like Mudit Bhardwaj. He is from Shyamalal College, and Dr. Manish is also in Shyamalal College, so I'm so happy to look at
evening, Shyamalal evening.
Shyamalal evening, yes, because I didn't know even Shyamalal. And very happy also to see Dr. Dian Singh. Perhaps I can see him after a long time, long years. So I'm so happy today. Today is Friendship Day also. So you have made the friends meet even on online, but that is very good. Thank you so much
for inviting. Okay, thank you. Thank you, Anupam ji. Bahut achha laga. Aap aaye. फिर और जगह मिलेंगे चलिए
यस मानवी
थैंक यू सो मच सर नाउ आई वुड लाइक टू कॉल मिस दिव्या फॉर वोट ऑफ थैंक्स
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन आई एम दिव्या त्यागी अ प्राउड मेंबर ऑफ साक्ष्य द हिस्ट्री सोसाइटी ऑफ शामलाल कॉलेज इवनिंग इट इज माय प्रिविलेज टू हैव बीन आस्क्ड टू प्रपोज अ वोट ऑफ थैंक्स ऑन द 25th सेशन द सिल्वर जुबली ऑफ ग्रेजुएट स्कॉलर्स टॉक सीरीज आई On behalf of Sakshya and the whole GSTS team, extend a hearty vote of thanks to everyone present here. First of all, I want to thank every single one of you who have been with us since the beginning of this series. We highly appreciate your constant love and support. This event would not have been possible without your presence, enthusiasm, and healthy criticism. We have completed 25 successful talks in this talk series, and there are many more to come. With your support, we are sure we will achieve great heights. As you all already know, that the Department of History is under the convenorship of Dr. D.N. Singh and under the guidance of Dr. Pramod Kumar sir, Dr. Manish Karambar sir, Dr. Seema Meena ma'am, and Mr. Ajay Kumar sir. In 2016-17, Sakshya was first formed, and the current office is Mandira Paul as Vice President, Mr. Shubham Tiwari as Secretary, Ms. Preeti Rai as Joint Secretary, and Ms. Tanya Sikarwar as Treasurer. Sakshya has organized quizzes, debates, lecture series, seminars, career counseling, and educational trips. Sakshya also organized the OBE seminar and the Graduate Scholars Talk series. This is a weekly talk series started to present the scholars' views on various topics to enhance their ideas and their speaking skills. Now, I wish to express my gratitude to the guest, Dr. Anupam Jha sir, for his kind and encouraging and informative words and for giving us his precious time. Thank you so much, sir. Now, I want to thank our principal, sir, for his precious time and kind words. Thank you so much, sir. My sincere thanks to all the faculty members who became a part of this event, and special thanks to Dr. Day and Dr. Ritu ma'am. I must mention a deep sense of gratitude to the speaker, Mr. Mudit Bhardwaj, for his explanation of the topic. Thank you so much, Mr. Mudit. The lecture was absolutely amazing, and it was absolutely amazing how you tackled all the questions. Now, I would like to take this opportunity to place on record our hearty vote of thanks to the GSTS team for their enormous cooperation in the organization of this event. I can't thank everyone enough for their involvement and their willingness to take on the completion of tasks, even in such difficult times. We are very proud of the whole team to complete 25 successful sessions in this event. Finally, I wish to thank all the students from various departments who joined us and became part of today's event. Thank you all so much for your time and patience. Once again, thank you all very much. Stay inside, stay safe, and take care of each other. We will see you on 8th of August 2021 with the next topic by Ms. Amrutha Ravishankar for her topic Electoral Democracy in India, Burning Issues and Reforms. Thank you all so much. We will see you next Sunday.
Thanks, Divya. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for joining. So this time for leave, because I'm the last person who is leaving. So kindly, this time for leave. Sorry to say that, but it's time for leave. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Gitanjali. Thank you, Prasant sir, Manu sir.
बहुत और बधाई मनीष जी आपको
इला भूषण मैम एवरीवन
आप इतना सक्सेसफुली काम कर रहे हैं सबको बधाई
प्लेजर इज आवर्स सर
मनु जी भी बधाई है मनु जी को भी बधाई
और डियर सॉरी फॉर जॉइनिंग लेट
जाओ अब परसों थैंक यू विदान थैंक यू
टॉक्स वर रियली नाइस आई रियली एंजॉयड लिसनिंग टू देम बोथ ऑफ
एंड दिस इज अ 25th टॉक कंटिन्यू
या 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 हां आई विल जॉइन फॉर आई विल डेफिनेटली जॉइन फॉर द नेक्स्ट वन
यस Thank you, Gitanjali. Thank you. Thank you.
And thank you, my students.
Leave करे ना हो गया.
हाँ. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
हाँ, डीएन सिंह.
Fourth वाले तो चार तारीख का.
अरे हाँ.
Sir, बाद में. इला मैम, thank you, ma'am.
चलिए.
हाँ ये हाँ.
कोई बात.
तो बाद में discuss कर लेंगे.
चल. ठीक है. अब क्या bye bye करें?
हाँ sir. हाँ 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 sir.
Okay.
हमको
प्रशांत जी bye bye.
थैंक यू सर थैंक यू
विकास विकास जी चले गए हाँ वो तो